Hey guys, so recently I've been having this back and forth kind of email conversation with this YouTube user. This YouTube user sent me a private message asking me questions about my views on, my atheistic views and things like that. So there was this back and forth conversation. I already uploaded a video in which I gave a first long response. And in this video, I'm going to be reading my second long response because he did respond back. And he responded back saying, he believes that Big Bang Theory would be compatible with the Bible, and evolution is not a proven thing, and he also said that life, it's great that you consider life to be a precious thing. So we both agree that life can be viewed as a gift. And he, of course, views it as life being a gift from God. But that he assumed wrong. And so this was my response to him. So I'm just going to read what I wrote back to him. This is what I said. This universe was not fine-tuned for life. That's such an incorrect belief. If the universe was fine-tuned, then either the designer was incompetent or the universe would have been much better designed. Also, if you're basing your belief of God and Jesus on the Bible, then do you realize how contradictory the Bible is in regards to the Big Bang? How do you explain the specific amount of days that the Bible says was the length of creation, which is 6 days, not including the seventh day in which God rested? I didn't include this in the note. This is a footnote that I'm adding for this video. Anyway, continuing on. How do you account for the fact that God first said, "Let there be light," when in actuality, according to the Big Bang Theory, the existence of light particles came into being much later? By believing in God and in the Big Bang, you're choosing which parts of the Bible you think is good, and ignoring large parts of the Bible that is completely wrong when put against modern science and modern ethics. Regarding evolution, we moved on from Darwin a long time ago. Theory of evolution via natural selection is bigger than Darwin. And never proven, you say? The fact that it's a scientific theory means that it's pretty much proven at this point, and it's more developed and established than the theory of gravity. Even by 1980, the oft-repeated Christian mantra, "There's no missing link fossils," has been proven to be wrong. The fact that you're saying all this about evolution seems to me that you don't know much about biology and evolutionary science. Footnote: this is coming from a guy that doesn't really know much about evolutionary science either, but from what I've read and seen and watched from, from lectures and things, Anyway, there's a huge consensus in the scientific community that, yeah, evolution is pretty much fact. I think you should research and read a bit more about evolutionary science. It's fascinating stuff, and eventually, I think you'll begin to see just how scientific and proven evolution already is at this point, and we're still building more and more mountains and mountains of evidence behind it. Anyway, on to the main point. Now, I said we are lucky to be alive, but that doesn't mean I consider life to be a gift. I don't think of it as a gift because, shoot, look at the world around you. Most of the world's populations live in poverty, under severe oppression, with awful diseases, genetic diseases, wars, genocides, institutional and direct racism, slavery, mass rape, on and on, all those kind of stuff. Even those who live with wealth suffer greatly, and some end up committing suicide or end up the victim of homicide, substance addiction, etc., etc., etc. If this life is God's idea of a gift, then God sure is a sadistic gift giver. We are fortunate to be alive in the universe in which 99.99999999999999% of matter is non-living and hostile to living things. Yes, it all is a matter of chance. It's like winning the lottery, though not quite exactly because, unlike the lottery, this isn't something that just someone gives to us or that we buy, but something that just happens. It's also not like, "Yay, I just won $1 million." Imagine if you were born as a chicken caged in a slaughterhouse. I wonder if you still consider life to be a gift. If you were born in North Korea as one of its poorest citizens and end up in its political prisons, and in there you're going to be routinely tortured there, I wonder if you still consider life to be a gift. Life is not a gift for most of us. It's just something we ended up having because of the process of the universe that's existed for 13.74 billion years. My saying that we would be viewed as worthless to an all-powerful being like a god, you're right that I didn't really derive that out of the Bible. I wouldn't disagree with you that the entire... I would disagree with you that the entire Bible is about Jesus. But I don't think you want to get into that kind of theology. So I won't talk too much about this point. And also, footnote here. This is not what I wrote. Also, I'm reading the entire Bible out loud on my channel. And you could clearly see most of what I read so far has nothing to do with Jesus. But anyway. Anywho, where I get that, the idea that we would be viewed as worthless to an all-powerful being like God, where I get that is from Christianity itself and other such religions. Just think about it. Any being, any powerful being who decides whether you deserve to suffer in hell for eternity or just obey and worship him forever, that being must see your worth as his lowly thing, you know, as something that he can control himself. He tortures, read the Old Testament and see how God treats human beings. You know, he tortures them and he kills them. If you do the math, God kills more people in the Old Testament than Stalin or Hitler ever did. If God didn't consider human beings as his worthless playthings, would he have been able to slaughter so many of them? Jesus is an interesting figure, I admit, though very derivative of so many other Messiah figures in pagan religions that existed long before the time Jesus was supposedly born. He said a lot of nice things, and he also said some terrifying things. For example, abandon your families and friends and only follow Jesus. Also, another example is he said that if people rejected him, then people will be thrown into hell. Terrifying things. But to believe that his death on the cross and supposed revival thousands of years ago actually means anything today is pretty ridiculous. Consider the basic tenet of Christianity. So this basic tenet, that God created hell for fallen angels, and then later decided those fallen angels should have rule over hell, and thus be able to put human souls into hell. That by that logic, it's God who is sending people to hell, however indirectly. And then, to save certain select group of human beings from ending up in hell, God decides to wait thousands of years before sending a human version of himself to earth, and then sacrificing himself / his son. But because he's God, he doesn't die, he comes back from the dead, and ascends back to heaven. Apparently, that is what enables all other human beings afterwards, and some Christians would argue retroactively, to all of those human beings have a get-out-of-hell card, as long as they choose to believe in it. So, by that logic, someone who murders and rapes 100 little girls can end up in heaven, as long as that someone at some time in his life, confesses his sins to Jesus and accepts in Jesus as his one and only Savior. Meanwhile, there's someone like Malala Yousaf, who right now is working hard to make sure girls around the world get provided educational opportunities, and recently she was the Nobel Peace Prize nominee. She'll end up in hell because she's a Muslim and doesn't believe in Jesus as a Savior. How does any of that nonsense have more meaning than the godless atheistic meaning I have made for myself? Anywho, on to the next question that you asked. Are people naturally good or evil? So I'm going to answer this question like I think Richard Dawkins would. That is, the question is kind of irrelevant when you consider how evolution via natural selection have worked so far, and how it works so that we end up with our concepts of morality and ethics. People are not naturally good or evil, but they're naturally interested in their survival and their well-being. That selfish nature is kept in check by the biological awareness that we as a species must survive, not only as individuals, but whole as species. Sorry, I lost where I was reading, because I was making hand gestures. Because they wouldn't survive as a species if they didn't have at least that kind of cooperation. Not to mention, morality and ethics are learned behaviors, so even those who are born with natural tendency to be good or to be evil, they can be taught and conditioned to be good or evil. But because human beings, like almost all other living things, are concerned with surviving and concerned with living happily and being satisfied, most human beings will come to agree to live under the ethics and morals that their surrounding societies have come to develop. Morality is relative, and depending on which society you live in, it has come to be shaped very differently. Similar to how different species or of animals have come to be shaped depending on where they live in. So, that's my long reply on all that. I hope I didn't sound So this was written wrong. I had a typo there, but I hope I didn't upset you too much with my reply. I personally find it fun to have this kind of discussion. I've accepted my apostasy a long time ago, so I have nothing to lose. I think you're very considerate to send me a PM instead of commenting on my bid because you're worried I'll get ganged upon. So footnote. So that's what he said in his private message to me, that he wanted to private message me instead of comment on my video because, like, he didn't want other people to also share his opinion, and it'll be like me arguing against 10 people or something like that. I guess it's considerate, but I actually don't mind being ganged upon like that. But you know, I am glad you PM'd me simply because on the comment section I have to contend with the 500 character limit, and as you can see, I tend to write quite a lot. So that was my reply to him. My second reply anyway, and then I think my third reply was probably my best reply to him. But you know, it's an interesting back and forth conversation, I think. I'm not really including what he wrote to me because I'm not sure if he's okay with me sharing that publicly, exactly what he wrote. I just kind of paraphrase what he wrote, and then I am comfortable with sharing what I wrote, so that's out there in the open. Anyway, yeah, and then my third reply, I think I'll also just share in the video format like this. But, yeah, hope you guys enjoyed. Cheers.